Okay, the next item of business is debate on motion 13041 in the name of Humza Yousaf on WASPI Women Against State Pension Inequality. I'd invite members wishing to participate to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. And I call on Humza Yousaf to speak to and move the motion, First Minister, around 11 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I move the motion in my name. Presiding Officer, I will undoubtedly miss being in government. It has been my life for the last almost 12 years. However, there will, of course, be some silver linings. The first, of course, the time I will be able to spend with my family, though I must confess that my 15-year-old daughter Maya didn't look overly excited by that prospect. The second is that I will be able to dedicate more time to my constituents and my constituency. And one part of my constituency that I share, actually, with Nicola Sturgeon is Govan. And it is within Govan that the Mary Barber statue is located. That monument was a very fitting endpoint to a march and rally organised by the WASPI women in 2019 that I had the pleasure of attending alongside my daughter Maya. And the reason why I took Maya to that march and rally was not just to tell her about the injustices that have been done to the WASPI women, but to show her the hundreds and the thousands of women who are standing up not just for their rights, but for the rights of all women and girls, regardless of their age. You see, Presiding Officer, the injustice done to the WASPI women is undoubtedly a gender injustice. There's no doubt in my mind, none whatsoever, that if men had been treated in this way, if they'd had their hard-earned money taken away from them with little or no choice, no notice, then not only would there be an outrage, but crucially, I suspect, the Westminster establishment would have found a solution. For years, the pleas of the WASPI women have fallen on deaf ears in the corridors of Whitehall. They've been ignored by the UK government, ignored by ministers, ignored by the Treasury, and virtually every member and department of the UK government. Any other campaign, any other campaigners, might have simply run out of steam, given up due to the intransigence of the political establishment in Westminster, but not the WASPI women. A number of the incredible women are in the public gallery today. You can see them just behind me. And they should be, Presiding Officer, commended and applauding for not taking no for an answer. So my thank you to the WASPI women for their tireless effort. They have, Presiding Officer, pursued every avenue possible to demand their rights. And I'm pleased that the Parliamentary and Health Service Ombudsman has agreed that the WASPI women have been wronged and deserve justice. Let me be clear, the Scottish Government doesn't just support the WASPI women's right to justice, that, of course, we do. We support their calls for compensation too. The PHSO report, finally published on the 21st of March after far too long a wait, criticises the handling of the DWP's communication of the equalisation of the state pension age for men and women, and calls for the women impacted by those failings to be compensated to the value of between £1,000 and £2,950. That's level four of the six levels of compensation available to them. But this government, the Scottish Government, recognises the WASPI campaign's call for the highest level of £10,000 or more to properly reflect the harm caused to those women over time. So the Scottish Government will do all we can to demand that Westminster does the right thing and fully compensate the women it has wronged. Presiding Officer, it's deeply disappointing. I've yet to receive a response to my letter that was sent both to the Prime Minister, but also to Sir Keir Starmer, stating that the current, or indeed any future UK government, must take action immediately to compensate the women impacted. I look forward to this chamber hopefully uniting today in agreement on righting an historic injustice. I note all leaders in this Parliament have pledged their support to the WASPI campaign and committed to their compensation. So while the Labour and Conservatives' recent commitments to the triple lock are critical, it is and would be a complete abandonment of the WASPI women that neither Rishi Sunak nor Keir Starmer pledged to deliver compensation to the women who've been affected. While in some respects, quite frankly, Presiding Officer, I would expect the Conservatives to shirk their responsibilities, for Labour to do the same is unforgivable. Labour politicians have taken great delight and turning up to photocalls with the WASPI women, wearing the purple sashes, promising to stand in solidarity with the women impacted. But it's not pictures, it's not warm words the WASPI women want. It is justice and it is compensation. Yes. If Keir Starmer and Rachel Reeves, the woman who is likely to be the next Chancellor of the UK, continue to turn their backs on the WASPI women by refusing to commit to compensation, it would be an absolute betrayal for which they should never be forgiven. The SNP-led Scottish Government has always supported the WASPI campaign, and we will always seek to do so. I was delighted to attend the recent WASPI gathering on the 18th of April in Parliament and talk to the WASPI campaigners, something I just had the pleasure of doing before this debate too. Each of the women there has a story. Women who wanted to spend this chapter of their lives free of any financial worries. To Anne, to Cathy, to Rosie, and the many other WASPI women who have had the privilege of meeting, your tireless campaigning has inspired me, most certainly, but politicians from right across the spectrum. And let me be very clear. On reaching this important milestone in your journey for justice, my colleagues and I, this government, will stand shoulder to shoulder with you until compensation has been paid in full. We also support SNP MP Alan Brown's bill currently making its way through the UK Parliament, calling for the UK government to compensate women born in the 1950s. I hope Tory and Labour politicians here, who will stand up shortly and tell WASPI women that they support their campaign, will put their money where their mouth is, that they will use any influence they have, regardless of how small it may be, in their own parties, and demand that their leaders in London do the right thing and compensate the WASPI women in full. No more excuses about how tight money is. We know how constrained the finances are. We know that. But this is about priorities, and the PHSO report makes it clear, and let me quote from them directly, finite resources should not be used as an excuse for failing to provide a fair remedy. We agree. Each day that passes without justice, the financial harm done to the women impacted increases. And of course, with the passage of time, more and more women affected will of course not live to see justice. The WASPI website has two counters on their homepage, one that keeps a tally of the number of WASPI women who have died and not received justice or compensation, and the other counter shows the total amount that the Treasury has saved through the disgraceful actions of the Westminster government. This morning, those counters showed that 277,389 women have died without being given compensation, and that the Treasury has disgracefully benefited to the tune of £4 billion. In Scotland alone, 336,000 women have been affected. Women who are owed between £300 million and £1 billion by the UK government just for the compensation recommended by the PHSO. That would be even more, of course, compensation if it reflected the WASPI campaign's own assessment of the harm that has been done. A survey of 8,000 WASPI women that was carried out in autumn of last year found that 70% of WASPI women had reduced their weekly spending and had cut their food shops in the past 6 months. So the UK government needs to step up. It needs to take responsibility for their failure to properly communicate the changes that have so adversely impacted these women. And if this uncaring, uncompassionate UK government isn't willing to do the right thing, then a potential future Labour government must stop the dithering, must stop the delay, and commit explicitly to full compensation for the WASPI women, and they should do so now, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, as I stated at the outset, this is a monumental failing of the UK government's own making. WASPI women maintain that they don't argue against equalisation in principle. However, the UK government's approach to equalisation of state pension age was badly communicated from the beginning. It led to millions of women across the UK being unfairly penalised. As I highlighted earlier, I've written to the Prime Minister to the Leader of the Opposition regarding the issue. And I also provided a copy of a letter from Anne Potter, coordinator of WASPI Glasgow, Lanarkshire, Dumbartonshire and Renfrewshire, Anne, who is known to many across this chamber. In that letter, Anne references the historic injustice that the millions of women and their families across the UK have faced throughout the WASPI scandal. But more pertinently, she makes the point that this can be overcome by politicians doing the right thing and working together. If nothing else, we owe it, all of us, to those who have already passed away without even receiving so much as an apology, let alone justice, let alone the compensation they deserve. So let the voices in this chamber unite. Let them be unequivocal in their cry. No ifs, no buts, no maybes. The UK government, current or future, must deliver fair and full compensation to all the women who have been impacted. And I can give WASPI women a personal promise. Be it from the front benches or indeed the back benches, they will always have my unwavering support and admiration. Thank you to all of the incredible, unrelenting WASPI women for not just fighting for yourselves, but thank you for fighting for my daughters too. And it is with great pride, Presiding Officer, that I move the motion in my name.
Thank you very much. Just to advise the Chamber, we have absolutely no time in hand this afternoon, so speeches will need to adhere to the time limits. And with that, I now call Douglas Ross to speak to and move Amendment 13041.2. Mr Ross, up to 7 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. And the First Minister began with reflections of a constituency case and a constituency campaign, and I want to do the same. I want to put on record in this Parliament my thanks and pay tribute to Sheila Forbes from Lossiemouth, who has been spearheading the campaign for WASPI women in Lossie and Moray and in many parts of Scotland for many years. Her tireless efforts deserve recognition, and indeed when I had a surgery just a few weeks ago in Lossie and an issue came up about WASPI women, in which I wrote to the Department for Work and Pensions, Sheila's name was mentioned. Because throughout some of the difficult times for the WASPI campaign in itself and some divisions within it, Sheila remained resolute to stand up for the women in Moray and wider communities who have been affected by this, continue to be affected by this, and indeed their friends and family. Because as the First Minister has said, people who started out on this journey are no longer with us, and the campaign for justice for WASPI women is not just for those who remain campaigning, and I welcome the campaigners here to the gallery today, but those who fought this battle but sadly did not see justice. Can I then come to the motion we have in front of us today and my amendment? The motion was lodged yesterday. This was a debate that got introduced yesterday, therefore it was after the First Minister wrote to party leaders to speak about the new approach we have to take, and indeed after the speeches he made at the weekend. So I hope on reflection he might look at the amendment that I put in and see nothing he can disagree with, and that's certainly been my intention. I think what I'm trying to do here is, in this new era of minority government, there is an opportunity for this Parliament to debate the, I will give way if I can finish this point, to debate these important issues, to work across the parties, to maybe have a discussion about some of the motions we are putting in and some of the outcomes we can have as a Parliament. And maybe throughout this debate, the First Minister might reflect on the contributions made and the wording of my amendment and consider actually accepting the amendment, which particularly focuses on the PHSO report. And I think it's crucial. There are issues here that look at the PHSO report and the wider campaign, but we can have a very strong voice in this Parliament today about the recommendations, including compensation for women affected by the changes and the maladministration that has clearly been identified in this report, while also considering the wider challenges faced with the bigger campaign. It has taken 5 years for the PHSO to conclude its report. That is a huge amount of work, and I want to see those recommendations taken on board, listened to and acted upon by the UK Government. And I think we can send a united voice from this Parliament on that issue. And I will give way briefly to the First Minister.
First Minister.
do thank Douglas Ross for taking an intervention. What I would say to Douglas Ross is that it is, of course, important for us to work collaboratively together. That also does mean being really upfront and honest with the campaigners and the public more generally. So can I just get this on the record and understand this from Douglas Ross, because I have no doubt he's read the PHS report in detail. Does he believe that the current UK government should be paying compensation to the women, the WASPI women who have been affected? Yes or no?
Douglas Ross.
Yes. Yes, I do. And that's what I've said. And in fact, my amendment states that the UK government should urgently address and respond to the recommendations of this report. And in fact, my amendment says, including the recommendation to pay compensation to those affected. The First Minister asked me a yes or no question, and the answer is yes. And this is what I want to do with this issue, because the First Minister is right. I have been supporting WASPI campaigners in Moray, in the House of Commons, and with their campaign. They deserve justice, and part of the road towards justice is taking the recommendations from this report and delivering on those. But timing is crucial as well. And in my letter to the Secretary of State for Work and Pensions, I was urging him and the UK government to respond to this report as quickly as possible. In response, Mel Stride has said they are looking at this and they are looking at all of the recommendations, including the recommendation to pay compensation. But the First Minister has also been correct to say this is an issue that is not and should not be political. There are members of every political party who have individually at a local level or nationally in Parliament raised this issue time and time again. I want to pay tribute to Carolyn Harris from the Labour Party, who in the UK Parliament, certainly did, I think still does, co-chair the WASPI APPG with my colleague, Conservative colleague Tim Lawton. The Conservative MP Peter Aldous repeatedly raises this issue time and time again. Patricia Gibson, most recently on behalf of the SNP, was challenging the UK government to respond to this report and the recommendations contained within the report as a matter of urgency. The WASPI women have got people from across the political spectrum to listen to their issues, to listen to their concerns, but crucially, on a non-partisan basis, the PHSO has listened to them, has accepted there was maladministration. And I think it's also very important to remember that the report could only look at not whether it was right or not to change the age of the state pension for women. And I again agree with the First Minister. No WASPI woman I have ever met was against the equality of that issue. It was how it was communicated. So from the very first moment I have spoken on this subject, I have raised concerns about how that was communicated. And there is no doubt from the summary of the complaint and the findings of this report that there was maladministration. It states clear that was maladministration. That was also maladministration. The maladministration has been rightly brought to the fore with this report, this comprehensive report, which does require thorough discussion, debate, and also a response from the UK government. That's why the amendment I brought forward today, I think, echoes much of what the First Minister himself was putting forward, but in a way that I think we can all support. And I would hope, as I said at the very beginning, in his reflections, he may consider today of all days and the work and the words he and the Deputy First Minister used today about this Parliament working together. Maybe he and the Scottish Government can accept our amendment today so this Parliament sends a united voice that we support the efforts of the WASPI women and we want to see the recommendations of this report promptly responded to by the UK Government. I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you. I now call Paul O'Kane to speak to move amendment 13041.1. Up to 6 minutes, Mr O'Kane.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I move the amendment in my name. And I welcome the debate today and this opportunity to join with colleagues in saying to the First Minister that I wish him well after the past week. And indeed, it is nice to debate him again. I think we last possibly did this when he was the Health Secretary and I was a Shadow Health Minister, and perhaps we'll have more time in the future to debate issues across this chamber. And I note what he said in his speech about this being a gendered issue, and I also note what Douglas Ross said about the timetabling of this debate being quite rushed, and I do hope that we will have time to debate the toxic masculinity debate that was intended to be in this slot soon as well, because I think those issues are really important to women and girls and to men, reflecting on their responsibilities across the country as well. And I wish to begin, Deputy Presiding Officer, as I often do in debates, by pointing to the consensus that I think is in the Chamber. And I think we've already heard this around the experiences of our constituents who are WASPI women. Scottish Labour welcome the publication of the Public Health Service Ombudsman's report. I think it has produced an incredibly detailed and serious piece of work, and it fully merits and must be given thoughtful and purposeful consideration and action. Because the report lays out clearly that there were failings in communications to changes to the state pension age. Labour opposed those changes at the time when George Osborne took the decision to accelerate increases in the state pension age without sufficient notice to women affected, an action which has rightly angered them. And I want to say to WASPI women on behalf of my party today, and to all those WASPI women who are in the gallery and who we represent, we want to thank them for their efforts and congratulate them, as the government's motion does, on the work that they have done to bring this report to this point. And indeed, I have had the opportunity to talk to many impacted constituents and WASPI campaigners, including recently at that drop-in the First Minister referred to, which I do thank Claire Hawkey for arranging as well. So the PHSO has been clear that it is now for government to respond, and they must do so at pace. WASPI women have been waiting long enough, and so this current government in the UK must set out how it will take forward the recommendations and next steps. Because I have to say that this current government have been slow to act on a range of injustices we have seen, whether that be the post office scandal or the infected blood scandal, which members will know are serious concerns of injustice at this time. And whilst we would appreciate that process has to be gone through and that there is detailed work to be done, it is clear that there must be speed in terms of the response of the Working Pension Secretary and the government, because people have waited too long. And very often on other issues, as I have mentioned, they can cross the line into what feels like apathy and a lack of feeling towards those who are victims of those injustices. And I think what is crucial in all of this is that we listen to the women who have the experience of having fought and campaigned over many years and have been seriously impacted by these issues. And the government needs to take the responsibility to engage with them and other stakeholders on how it's going to address these findings. So let me be absolutely clear. Labour does support the delivery of justice for WASPI women, but we've also been clear. We have been absolutely clear that we support justice for WASPI women. I assume the First Minister wishes to intervene. I'm not sure when that photo was taken, but it certainly doesn't look like that at the end of this week, but maybe in the future, I'll give way.
First Minister.
Presiding Officer, that is an awfully cruel thing to add insult to injury, I have to say, to put up a photo where I... It was only yesterday, actually, that photo. In all seriousness, the point of consensus between Paul O'Kane and I is that nobody is arguing about the maladministration and the bad communication from the UK government. There's also no disagreement between Paul O'Kane and I about the fact that Conservatives are unlikely to act. So the WASPI women I met this afternoon had a very clear question. It is no different to the question I asked Douglas Ross. If there is a future UK Labour government, can Paul O'Kane commit that they will pay compensation? Let's not argue about the level of compensation, but will they pay compensation to the WASPI women affected if the Conservatives don't act? Yes or no?
Paul O'Kane.
I thank the First Minister for that intervention. And I had this conversation with WASPI women in this very Parliament at that event that I spoke about as well, and we were very clear that we support the principles contained within the PSHO report, which is a principle to compensate those women. He says that let's not talk about the level, but of course his motion does speak in quite specifics about the level. So I do think we have to reflect on that as well. I think I'm clear. Deputy Presiding Officer, that we are in support of the principle of compensation. So I'm not quite. No, I'm. Excuse me.
Yes. Mr. O'Kane.
Excuse me.
Mr. O'Kane, resume your seat a second. We've listened to all of the speakers so far with courtesy and respect. Can we continue in a similar vein? Paul O'Kane.
Thank you. And I think what's important to the WASPI women who are listening in the gallery is that they heard what I've just said, instead of the barracking that we had from the backbenchers who clearly want to make this a political issue about the Labour Party. So, Deputy Presiding Officer, as I have said already, Labour supports the delivery of that justice for WASPI women. But we are very, very clear that we need to ensure that WASPI women are part of that process, that we ensure that any system of compensation has to be designed with those women in mind and round the table in making those decisions, because the Ombudsman has made a number of recommendations about how any such system might move forward. Of course, that could be, of course, blanket compensation, or it could be looking at individual cases, and I know there is a variance of views from many women on what should be done there. I am very conscious that the Deputy Presiding Officer is looking at me to wrap up, and we have had a number of exchanges within that. But I am very clear, as I said at the outset, that Labour will support the WASPI women, that we will support the outcomes of this recommendation within the report, and indeed that we will support pensioners more widely through the triple lock and other measures that we will seek to take. So I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr O'Kane. I now call Maggie Chapman up to 4 minutes. Ms Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Apologies. Every 13 minutes, a WASPI woman dies. Every 13 minutes, a woman who might have lost several years' worth of her pension, maybe as much as £42,000, dies without justice. Because of changes made in the 1995 State Pension Act, designed to equalise pensions, women born in the 1950s have lost out, with as many as 3.6 million women affected. And this number includes at least 23,000 women in Aberdeen and Aberdeenshire. None of these women disagrees with the pension equalisation. They do, however, disagree with the unfair way in which the changes were introduced. Significant changes to their pension age were imposed without widespread consultation, with little or no notice, and much faster than they were promised. And some women have been hit by more than one increase with subsequent pension changes in 2011. In March this year, as we've heard, the Parliamentary and Health Service Ombudsman ruled that the UK government had mishandled changes to the pension age, leaving many of those women facing hardship. Until the 1990s, many women were not allowed to join company pension schemes. And because they didn't have time to plan for the pension changes, they are now struggling to make ends meet. Many other women affected started working before equalities legislation came into place in the 1970s. Many were forced to leave work if they got married, and many didn't get maternity pay if they had children. Older women now are often not able to find appropriate jobs, and many cannot work as they are carers for other family members or are themselves not able to work because of their own health conditions. The WASPI women have been subjected to systematic discrimination, and the pension fiasco is just the latest example. It should also be noted that many older women, when in receipt of either a salary or a pension, tend to spend that money in their local economies. So it is not just the women and their immediate families who have lost out and suffered, but their wider communities, our communities too. In the recent report, the PHSO also said that the affected women should be paid up to £2,950 each by way of compensation for hardship faced, because the UK government had mishandled changes to the pension age. And this mishandling, this maladministration, had left many of them facing hardship. WASPI women, and probably many of us in this chamber, think that this level of compensation suggested is, and I quote, a WASPI woman, a slap in the face. It is appalling that the DWP responsible for the Small Administration has said it will not pay even this measly amount. As Linda Carmichael, co-chair of WASPI Scotland, says, an apology doesn't pay the bills. After the publication of the PHSO report, another WASPI campaigner, Lorraine Ray, has said, and I quote, we are pleased that after a long wait, we have been vindicated and have achieved a moral victory. But we must now also be compensated financially for the losses we suffered. We now require compensation without a protracted period of debate and stalling, during which many more WASPI women will die before receiving what they are due. I want to pay special tribute to Linda and Lorraine for their tireless work in Aberdeen, and indeed all the phenomenal WASPI women campaigners across Scotland. I know they will not let up in their fight for fair and fast compensation. We should all be able to stand in solidarity with WASPI women, our mothers, sisters, carers, neighbours and friends in their fight for justice. In closing, Presiding Officer, I'm pleased to reaffirm my and the Scottish Greens' unwavering support for the WASPI campaign. We believe the WASPI women should have fair and fast compensation, and we urge the UK Government to act, and act quickly, to prevent any more damage to WASPI women. Thank you.
Thank you. Just a reminder, we have no time in hand, and therefore you will need to stick to your speaking limits from now on. Beatrice Wishart, up to 4 minutes, please, Ms Wishart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the opportunity to debate the Ombudsman's recommendations this afternoon, and as Deputy Convener of the Scottish Parliament's cross-party group for WASPI, I recognise the hard work of all those involved in the campaign. And just in case it wasn't obvious, Presiding Officer, I should confess that I am a 1950s woman as well. I have friends and family, as I'm sure colleagues do across the chamber, affected by the decision to increase the state pension age. And as the First Minister said, it was never about the equalisation, but how it was done. There's a distinct feeling of a lack of fairness involved, with a sense that the goalposts were moved without being informed. We can debate whether this would ever have happened if we were talking about another group in society. But a combination of misogyny and ageism resulted in older women being overlooked by grey suits in Whitehall. Little wonder older women feel invisible in our society. The word WASPI quickly became a catch-all for all the various groups who've campaigned about the lack of notice for increasing the state pension. The WASPI campaigners have only ever asked for fairness and to rectify injustices. Sadly, some of those campaigners have passed away and will not see the justice they sought. The irony is not lost that WASPI women are from the generation who campaigned for women's rights. We shouldn't forget that the rights that women have today are in no small way due to the women who were born in the 1950s. Maternity pay and maternity leave were not available to women who had their children in the 60s and early 70s. And when they came to retirement, some women made decisions about their future, such as offering childcare for grandchildren, only to cruelly find that financially they wouldn't be able to do so. They've had to continue to work or take additional part-time, often low-paid jobs, just to survive the years when they thought they would have their state pension. Close the Gaps briefing reminds us that there's a gendered element to pension inequality. Women are likely to take on more caring responsibilities with interruptions in their careers, reducing opportunities to contribute to pension savings. Women are living longer and more likely to live in poverty after retirement, with fewer savings than men. And Close the Gap highlight that two-thirds of pensioners in poverty are women and half of pensioners in poverty are single women. And I'm quite sure WASPI women know the reality of that. The Ombudsman report's been a long time coming. The process needs to be moved along to ensure those affected finally get compensation. I urge the UK Government to act on the Ombudsman's report and encourage whichever party forms the next government after the general election to make this a priority. It should be remembered that this will not be simply an outgoing from Treasury. There will be returns to local economies and national taxes from compensation payments. So to conclude, Presiding Officer, the 1950s women we've been talking about were among the first to vote at 18, saw several waves of feminism and new protections under legislation, yet as working citizens they were let down by the state. It's past time to rectify this injustice. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Wishart. We move to the open debate. I call first Kenneth Gibson, to be followed by Ros McCall. Up to 4 minutes, Mr Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I pay tribute to all Women Against State Pension Inequality campaigners, in particular Ayrshire WASPI, who many MSPs met when they visited Parliament 2 weeks ago. Their dedication, courage and tireless advocacy has shone the brightest light possible on the injustice facing women born in the 1950s. This is, of course, a problem created by successive Labour, Coalition and Tory Westminster governments which raised the state pension age for women without giving them due notice. As a result, 3.7 million women across the UK born between the 6th of April 1950 and 5th of April 1960 were thrown into an impossible situation, including more than 336,000 in Scotland and 6,940 in North Ayrshire and Arran constituency alone. Department of Work and Pensions figures make plain the scale of the hardship. In North Ayrshire and Arran, between 2013 and February 2021, the number of women aged 60 and above claiming incapacity benefits rose 315%, while working age out of work benefit claims increased 472%. This is a generation of women that had already been victims of pay discrimination. Without enough notice to financially plan, WASPI women found themselves having to work years longer than anticipated. Many who could not or retired from work anticipating the state pension have endured financial hardship because they were then unable to access the pension they deserve and were promised. I know from speaking to women affected by this scandal how much it has devastated lives. Pushed into poverty as what savings they had dwindled away, women have had to abandon plans to care for elderly or infirm relatives or take low-paid, insecure or manual work. The scale of this injustice is matched only by the dignity of the WASPI campaign itself. After 5 long years, the UK Parliamentary and Health Service Ombudsman published its final report on women's state pension age. The report vindicated campaigners, finding thousands of women impacted by the DWP's maladministration and failure to properly notify them about changes to their state pension age, stating, "Women lost opportunities to make informed decisions about their finances. It diminished their sense of personal autonomy and financial control." Despite this vindication, the Ombudsman cannot force the UK government to pay compensation. Shockingly, the DWP indicated its refusal to comply, leading the Ombudsman to take the rare but necessary step of asking Parliament to intervene. However, following a statement on women's state pension age at Westminster on 25th of March, neither the Tories nor Labour is committed to delivering any compensation. Despite at least 12 shadow cabinet members and Keir Starmer previously supporting calls for restitution, not a single one repeated that backing following the Ombudsman's report. Meanwhile, presiding officer, more than 277,000 WASPI women have already passed away without receiving any recompense. More WASPI women die each new day of dither, delay and deferment from the UK Government and His Majesty's loyal opposition. The SNP, in contrast, demands that after years of UK Government inaction, WASPI women must now receive the justice, apology and compensation they deserve without further delay. My wife, MP for North Ayrshire and Arran, Patricia Gibson, has vigorously championed the cause of WASPI women, as Douglas Ross pointed out, and is the only MP to have spoken in every Westminster debate on this subject since her election in 2015. She will lead a backbench business debate in the House on the 16th of May, after which MPs will vote on whether or not they support justice, delivering prompt compensation for WASPI women. For it's not the warm words offered by the Tories and Labour today they seek, but recompense. We will see then where each party truly stands on this important issue.
Thank you, Mr. Gibson. I now call Ros McCall to be followed by Marie McNair. Up to 4 minutes, Ms. McCall.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. It wouldn't be a contribution from me unless I started with the personal anecdote. As a child that grew up in the 1970s in Glasgow and hit the job market in the late 1980s, the position of female equality was still moving on from legislation such as the Sex Discrimination Act. I think it's hard for women now to even imagine a Scotland where they were not allowed to have a bank account or a bank loan without the additional signatory on the account of a father or a husband, but that's how it was. The idea of feminism and pure, undiluted equality was an absolute driving force for me. It was well discussed that there would have to be some radical changes to allow women and men to be treated equally within the law. Some of them would be good, some of them would be bad, but it was universally accepted that radical change was needed nonetheless. And in 1995, when the State Pension Act included plans to increase women's state pension age from 60 to 65, with the gradual increase that was to take place over a decade, it was pretty much accepted, and I certainly don't have any recollection of myself or my friends or anyone really disagreeing with the need for a more equal state pension process encompassing men and women. So I think it's important to mention this because we should actually be mindful that the report from the Parliamentary and Health Service Ombudsman isn't actually looking at that decision, and that's been mentioned already, but rather that the report was to investigate how the decisions that were being made were communicated and explained and their failings. Firstly, I want to mention the fact that the Ombudsman has taken over 5 years to produce this final report. I think that reflects the complexities surrounding this matter, and I understand the strong feelings on the issue. So it's right that due care and attention was given when producing the report. It's right that the investigation considers approximately 30 years. It's right it goes all the way back to 1995. And it's right that all changes made throughout successive governments were thoroughly investigated. But as I said, the debate before us isn't questioning the decisions themselves, but the communication of them. And I quote the opening sentence from the motion: the Parliament welcomes the report from the Parliamentary and Health Service Ombudsman. So it's in that context that we're discussing, and I do welcome the report. It's a serious report which requires serious consideration, and I want to place on record my view that we must continue to have dialogue with all those who have been impacted. And as our amendment states, the UK Government must respond in full to the substantial report and the recommendations contained within it as quickly as possible. I also agree with the recommendation to pay compensation to those affected, and I add my congratulations to the WASPI women and campaigners for their hard work and diligence in getting to this point. Now the Ombudsman has provided the information, the UK Government has agreed to consider the report's findings and will bring back an update to Parliament. I think that's absolutely right, but they must do it at pace. Of course, there were numerous findings within the report and some of its conclusions around access to information, complaint handling and the introduction of transitional arrangements are also very important to consider and should certainly form part of a broader reflection by the UK Government. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, I applaud the UK Government's commitment to the full and proper consideration of the Ombudsman's report and to do its continued full and constructive engagement. I wait to hear their findings with interest, and I state we need to do it at pace. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms McCall. I now call Marie McNair to be followed by Katie Clark. Up to 4 minutes, Ms McNair.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's a pleasure to speak in this debate, and I thank the First Minister for bringing this to the Chamber. WASPI women work tirelessly throughout their lives only to find themselves facing a six-year delay to receiving their pension. In this left many struggling to make ends meet and facing financial uncertainty at a time when they should have been able to relax and put their feet up. It's estimated that in my constituency, more than 4,700 women in Eastern Bartonshire and over 6,000 in Western Bartonshire have been affected by the changes to the state pension age. I welcome the report from the Parliamentary and Health Service Ombudsman into the pensions injustices on women born in the 50s. It's clear on the damning failures of the UK Government and their need to act now. They need to deliver on the recommendations to pay compensation in full to these women without any further delay. The Ombudsman report is clear. Some women born in the 1950s were not adequately informed of the impact of the changes. Accurate and timely information had not been given to millions of women in the UK, including 356,000 in Scotland. These women were unfairly penalised for circumstances out with their control, facing the consequences of a policy that was not properly communicated to them. And this gave most of them no time to prepare. And as noted by my colleague Alan Brown MP, who I commend for his unwavering commitment on this issue, these are the very same women who were paid less than men, who didn't have maternity rights, and those private pensions were smaller than men's pensions, if they had them at all. So by raising the pension age without due notice, these women were further penalised. I met with WASPI women, including some of my own constituents, at the parliamentary demonstration a couple of weeks ago, and I was proud to stand with them in their fight, and I was glad to get the chance to speak more with them. The recommended payouts are paltry sums, and I echo the WASPI women's calls for compensation that reflect decades of mistreatment. These women are here to stay, and we will keep fighting for them. And in the face of injustice, the WASPI women have shown determination and courage. They have spent considerable time advocating for change and raising awareness of their plight. There are so many WASPI women groups who have done so much amazing work. And in my constituency, I am proud to support the Western Bartonshire Women Against State Pension Injustice Group. Their coordinator, Liz Daly, whom I have met with several times now, has committed so much time to the cause, and for that I am so grateful. This group and all WASPI women will be remembered for their resilience, determination and unwavering commitment to justice. And I will always be a supporter of the WASPI women alongside my SNP colleagues here today. But of course, the fight is not over. The Westminster Government made a real mess of this, and it's time for the women to receive their rightful compensation. The Tory Government must act and right this wrong. If not them, then Labour must commit to compensate WASPI women. So I generally ask again, Labour MSPs here, for their commitment. I don't want a faked manufacturer position to be used in Scotland in this debate, as so far their leader has refused to commit to compensating these women, which is shameful, and that's a betrayal of every single WASPI woman. We need cross-party commitments to ensure justice is delivered for these women. They've waited too long. The time is now to provide fast and fair compensation. Time will tell, and unfortunately, what WASPI women don't have is time. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Katie Clark to be followed by Kevin Stewart. Up to 4 minutes, Ms Clark.
It is a pleasure to get the opportunity to contribute to this important debate and to call on the UK Government to take action now to deliver justice and compensation for WASPI women. WASPI women are calling for the UK Government, Secretary of State for Work and Pensions, Mel Stride, to come to the Chamber of the House of Commons to outline his response to the recent report from the Parliamentary and Health Service Ombudsman, and to come forward with his government's proposal to address this injustice. This Parliament should also be calling for that. And frankly, it is astonishing that there hasn't even been a statement in the House of Commons up till now. As convener of the cross-party group on WASPI since 2021, it has been a pleasure to work with WASPI campaigners in Scotland, some of whom are in the gallery today, some of whom have had 3 visits to this Parliament in the last fortnight to lobby politicians, and who have consistently campaigned for justice for women who were born in the 1950s and indeed for compensation. And we know that many of the women affected are in financial difficulties. MSPs and indeed MPs from all political parties represented in this chamber have been involved in the cross-party group, and it would have been helpful to have an agreed motion to come out of this Parliament today. A great deal of work was undertaken by Labour prior to the 2021 general election, which included a manifesto commitment with a detailed package of compensation. Labour, of course, were not elected, and it is for the Conservatives to deliver justice now. Last month, the Parliamentary Health and Service Ombudsman published his long-awaited Stage 2 and Stage 3 reports on the Department of Work and Pensions maladministration, and it's maladministration only that that report deals with. The WASPI campaign was launched in 2021. We know that since then, it is estimated that 277,400 WASPI women have died, and it is estimated that one 1950s woman born in that time dies every 13 minutes. One third of WASPI women are in debt, and one in four are living under the poverty line. In Ayrshire, it is estimated that 26,590 women have been affected. And WASPI campaigners in Ayrshire have done considerable work to quantify the loss to those women, the loss to the communities in which they live, and indeed to make the case that compensation paid to these women would mainly be spent in local communities and indeed would be a benefit to the whole of the local community. I think it's fair to say that many WASPI women are very disappointed that after a 67-month-long investigation, the levels of compensation proposed are relatively low. The Ombudsman's report, of course, related to maladministration only. The UK Government must come forward quickly with its response to this report and indeed to proposals. And if they don't deal with it, the next UK Government must. We must deliver justice and compensation to these women.
Thank you. I now call Kevin Stewart to be followed by Jeremy Balfour. Up to 4 minutes, Mr Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank the First Minister for bringing this debate today. I know that many folk heard the First Minister speak at Claire Hawkey's event with WASPI Women the other week, and it is very clear the First Minister's passion for this issue. I had the pleasure of meeting some Aberdeen WASPI campaigners at Claire Hawley's event, Linda and Helen. People who have campaigned very hard for justice. And I always enjoy meeting Linda and Helen, but I would like to meet with them under different circumstances after they have been paid the compensation that they rightly deserve. And I think we have to look at these scenarios very closely. These women, many of whom had built their lives around a specific retirement plan, were forced to keep working years longer than anticipated in many cases. And this was not just an economic hardship. It was a betrayal of trust. And it is estimated that almost 356,000 women in Scotland were impacted by the WASPI pension scandal. Many were already in ill health, and others had taken early retirement and were planning to get by until age 60 when they thought they would receive their state pension. Now, the UK government continues to argue that communication happened, but let's be clear, the rug was pulled out from underneath these women. The Parliamentary Health and Health Service Ombudsman has judged that the UK government failed to adequately inform thousands of women that the state pension age had changed. WASPI women are not asking for handouts. They are asking for recognition of the burden placed upon them and compensation for the additional years worked. And the strength and perseverance of the WASPI women are an inspiration. They have raised their voices, and it's time for the UK government to listen and, more importantly, act. Now, we've heard from some speakers today around about more dialogue. Now is not the time for more dialogue. There's been too much dialogue. It is time to compensate these women. But in all of this, this is not just about the past. It's about the future. We cannot allow similar situations to happen again. Transparency and clear communication about pension changes are absolutely essential. Supporting the WASPI woman is also about ensuring that today's working age adults don't have their pensions whisked away by the swish of a Westminster ministerial pen. And let's be crystal clear, if the Tory government and maybe a Labour government to follow get away with this outrage against the WASPI woman, they'll be coming for the pensions of the rest of us next. And just today, the UK Prime Minister Rishi Sunak refused to rule out raising the state pension to age 75. What happened to the WASPI woman sets the stage for what Westminster may well do next. And if they get away with their outrageous treatment of WASPI women, they will try it on with everyone else. Let's make sure that the WASPI women get justice. Let's compensate these women now.
Thank you. I now call Jeremy Balfour to be followed by Christine Graham. Up to 4 minutes, Mr Balfour.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. It's always good when we get to discuss Social Security in the Scottish Parliament. I have to say that I think this is possibly the most stacked the front benches have been on Social Security debate in a long time. However, I suspect that it's not just the topic, but the person moving the motion that has drawn people here this afternoon. And, Presiding Officer, I hope that the First Minister has chosen this topic as his swan song in order not just to take one last shot at the UK Government, but actually to bring together this chamber so that we can unite. And I hope he has taken seriously the offer in the amendment by those on this benches, and that the Government will accept it so that we can have a voice going back to London, which represents the whole of this Parliament. Because the picture we see before us is that the UK Government is taking time to consider carefully the findings of the report to find the best and most substantial way forward. That has to be correct. We must get this right because people have waited too long. No one in this chamber, no one in this debate is denying that the situation that we have reached is regrettable. Women planned their lives around the information they had at the time, and there can be no doubt that this situation has left them worse off. That does not negate the fact that the governments have responsibility to ensure that any and all unintended consequences are taken into account before any decision is made. We cannot rush in to making decisions. We have seen in this Parliament, when rushed decisions are made, when bad legislation is brought forward, it then doesn't survive the time going forward. President Officer, of course we want the WASPI women to be given a fair deal. Apart from the fact that it is the right thing to do, they have fought hard and run a successful campaign over the last number of years that deserves a just solution. But we must ensure that the compensation is affordable and allows our social security system across the whole of the United Kingdom to remain sustainable. That, after all, has to be our consideration when taking any form of social security decision. There has to be an acknowledgement that decisions that are made today will have consequences that reach far into our future. Unfortunately, I just don't have the time on this occasion. It is a consideration that has been unfortunately lacking sometimes here in Scotland since the partial devolution of benefit. We here in Scotland are fast racking up a bill that will become unsustainable even by 2026. On the topic of pension compensation, as with Social Security more broadly, we have to balance our generosity with our responsibility. To close, Presiding Officer, I welcome the report and look forward to the full response of the UK Government when we have fully considered how to move forward in a fair and affordable way. All those involved deserve nothing less, and I hope that the UK Government will respond in a speedy and appropriate manner. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Balfour. I now call Christine Graham to be followed by Claire Baker. Up to 4 minutes. Ms. Graham.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. First of all, I commend the WASPI women in Midlothian, South Tweedale and Lauderdale and across Scotland for their resilience and determination to see justice for all women affected by the unilateral changes to the state pension. Indeed, I myself tabled a motion in March this year as follows, and I'll truncate it, that the Parliament recognises the report's findings, which reflect on failings by the DWP to provide accurate, adequate and timely information about changes to the state pension age for women, acknowledges what it sees as the significant detrimental impact that the DWP's failure to communicate effectively has had on the affected women's ability to plan for their retirement and the financial implications this has created. Deprived of the pension that they rightly deserve, and further believes that their fight for justice is taking far too long to be adequately addressed, and urges the UK Government to acknowledge the DWP's failings, as highlighted in the report, issue an immediate apology, and deliver fair compensation, and so on, close quotes. Now, I do want to be consensual, but I know nobody from Labour, nobody from the Tories, nobody from Liberal Democrats signed that motion, which I don't think is a hostile motion. But I consider as a fact that the provision of the state pension is a contract between the government. So the unilateral variation of the terms of that, quotes, contract, quotes, should not have been implemented. I think we all agree that as times have moved on, the equalisation of men and women's eligibility for the state pension, but the manner in which eligibility for the state pension was increased was at best clumsy and at worst brutally unjust. The latter is supported by that parliamentary report by the Parliament and Health Services Ombudsman. Which brings me to the yawning gap between the compensation level recommended in that report, which is between £1,000 and £2,950, and the claim of the WASPI women, which I don't think is over the top, for £10,000. Maggie Chapman quite rightly drew attention to the fact that a woman who has been lost 7 years of it might have lost £40,000 in value. Now, even the 2950 is derisory, as the moving finishing line for retirement age has left and will leave many in financial difficulties. Indeed, the recent announcement that a failed asylum seeker who volunteered to be transported to Rwanda was given £3,000 cash and other expenses paid. So that puts in even more context of what a slap in the face this is to the WASPI women. A survey of 8,000 WASPI women carried out in autumn 2023, and I'll be brief, found that 25%, a quarter, had struggled to buy food in the past 6 months. What a condemnation. I know when I myself became eligible for the state pension, and I say to Beatrice Wishart, unfortunately, I was born in the 40s, I had planned my finances on that basis that I would retire at 60. I didn't know I was coming here. Especially to time the paying off of my mortgage, having divorced in my late 50s. And divorce is not uncommon these days in older people. This adds to the financial pressures on women who may have been relying on a partner to support them and for them mutually to finance each other. So UK ministers must set up a compensation scheme that provides full and genuine compensation for the women concerned. Look at the figures I've quoted. So far, the Conservative government and Labour opposition have not come forward with such a scheme, and I think it's time to walk the walk. No more talking about it. We know the position. It has fallen to the SNP people like Patricia Gibson to push for justice. But I have to say, and perhaps not the kindest of note, perhaps that's why no Labour or Tory MSPs signed my motion in the first place.
Thank you. I now call the final speaker in the open debate, Claire Baker, up to 4 minutes. Ms Baker.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I want to begin by recognising the significance of this debate from the WASPI women and their ongoing work in the pursuit of justice. They have been tenacious in fighting their cause. It is important that the UK Government makes no further delay in responding to the findings of the Ombudsman's report. The current Government must respond, and it cannot leave it to the next Government to clear up this mess. The Chancellor's comment that there is no secret vault of money is a far from helpful response. We are well aware of the sorry state of the UK Government's finances as a result of mismanagement and unfunded spending commitments at the hands of the Conservatives. Regrettably, there are other examples of the UK Government trying to delay resolution when it comes to them being at fault. The Post Office Horizon cases, the contaminated blood scandal and the Windrush compensation scheme all have parallels. While the UK Government argues that the information on the changes was provided through some routes, the Ombudsman's report is clear in its conclusions that it failed in communication and this is maladministration. Decision-making by the DWP did not give proper weight to targeted information, that research, the need to appropriately target information was ignored, and as a result the public wasn't provided with as full information as possible. It failed to promptly write to affected women, taking years longer than it should have, and further restricting the ability of many women to adjust their retirement plans. The WASPI campaign argues that many affected women, in fact, did not find out about the change until as late as 2012. Some had only 1 year's notice of a six-year delay to their retirement, and many had already left work. Across the chamber, it is true that some of us are closer to retirement than others, but most of us will have thought about our retirement or are actively planning for it. For many people approaching the end of their working life, to find out that rather than being able to retire in a year's time, they have another 6 years before that can happen, this would have a huge impact, not just financially, but also mentally. Women who have planned for retirement at 60 may have been expected to take on caregiver roles, which they were then not able to do if they had to continue working. And those who were unable to stay in employment had to rely on savings to get by. There was no secret vault of money for them either, but they had to somehow make it work. Today, if you want to check when you will reach state pension age, you can do it almost immediately on the government's website. That currently comes with a caveat. It may increase by up to a year for those born between April 1970 and 1978, as well as a general note on the potential for change. But we know that misleading information on the pension age for women was still on the government website until as late as 2016. And Labour has called for an improved notification system that will ensure future generations are able to properly plan for retirement with timely and targeted information. We must take lessons from this process. It has highlighted the importance of properly considering correspondence and complaints, and particularly looking at patterns and potential consequences. And there are similarities here with the Horizon scandal. We also need to be aware that, as the DWP's own research showed, making policy announcements is not enough. As members of Parliament or Government, we need to be realistic and recognise that at times we operate in a bubble and that most people do not keep on top of policy announcements. The personalisation of news consumption, the fog of disinterest, the sheer breadth of information available, the burying of bad news, this can all add up to a lack of awareness that we need to work to address. We need to ask ourselves whether the duty of government to communicate is always sufficient or whether more needs to be done to engage. And on the issue of WASPI women, we need to see immediate response from the UK Government and a resolution to this situation. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Baker. We now move to closing speeches, and I call first Maggie Chapman. Up to 4 minutes, Ms Chapman.
Apologies. Thank you, Presiding Officer. The First Minister is absolutely right. If such an injustice had been experienced by men, the way that the WASPI women have been treated, something would have been done, and done years ago, to remedy the injustices they faced. These injustices are typical of the structural and systemic inequalities that women face in many, some would say all, aspects of life. Despite equalities legislation being in place for decades, we still see gender pay gaps, unequal access to services, the labour market, benefits and so much more. And we know that inequalities and discrimination don't stop there. So it is right that perhaps in stark contrast to the last couple of weeks in Scottish politics, there has been a fair degree of consensus across the chamber today. I wish we could get such agreement on all equalities issues. I want to thank those who have contributed to the debate today. I think it is important that so many different WASPI groups and women have been recognised and celebrated in this chamber. I hope we see the political action at Westminster to match the words we've heard here this afternoon. Turning briefly to the two amendments we have in front of us, I've listened carefully to the contributions from both Douglas Ross, Paul O'Kane and their colleagues. Despite the agreement we have, I'm afraid I cannot support the Conservative amendment because it removes the clause that talks specifically about the need for a higher level of compensation for WASPI women to properly reflect the financial harm they have faced. Yes.
Douglas Ross.
Maggie Chapman, forgive me. As I was trying to explain in my speech, I think we can come back to the wider issue of the full compensation in a separate debate, but there would be an opportunity today to focus on the PHSO report, which was the bulk of the government motion, and that would send a very strong message if we could unite around that and then come back to the other issues at another time.
Maggie Chapman.
For that intervention, and I think we do have agreement around the PHSO's report. However, I consider the element that you have removed, that fuller compensation, fairer compensation, to be a vital and intrinsic aspect of the WASPI campaign, one that Scottish Greens support, so I believe we should retain it today. As far as the Labour amendment goes, I agree with the principle and sentiment of it and the detail of most of it. Greens have long supported and called for a clear system of notifications about future pension changes. We have always supported the pension triple lock, and I'm glad to have the opportunity to put that on the record again today. But we cannot endorse what is clearly part of the Labour general election campaign machine, so we will abstain on this amendment this afternoon at decision time. But in closing, Presiding Officer, I thank the Scottish Government for bringing this debate today and colleagues across the Chamber for their contributions. But most of all, I thank the WASPI women for their tireless fight for fair and fast compensation, for justice. While we have been here this afternoon, 7 WASPI women might have died without that justice. We should act together for them, and the UK Government definitely must. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Chapman. I now call Michael Mara up to 6 minutes. Mr Mara.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I begin by joining all colleagues in paying tribute to the WASPI women and their campaigning. Scottish Labour are supportive of them in their campaign for justice. And the report from the Parliamentary and Health Service Ombudsman is a major and vital step forward in that campaign, that search for justice. And it's one which the Labour Party welcomes. It does demand full consideration and robust action from the UK Government. It's clear these women have been dreadfully let down by the changes made by the UK Government to their pension provision. Lives were altered forever. by the government's failure to communicate the impact of changes to the state pension age. Beatrice Wisher, I thought, very eloquently set out the impact on so many women across Scotland. Their plans for retirement, the life they hoped for, caring for grandchildren snatched from them, the hopes that they held for their later years cruelly dashed. And as highlighted by many colleagues, there have been parliamentarians from across all parties that have stood alongside those WASPI women, sometimes when they were less listened to than they are now, and less vindicated than they are now by this report. They have listened, they have demanded action, and those parliamentarians changed the debate in their own parties. I met Patricia Gibson, MP, for the first time on a Finance Committee visit to Westminster just a few weeks ago, and she had come directly from the Chamber where she had been raising this exact issue, which I know she has done time and again, alongside colleagues from many parties, but I pay tribute to her for that work as raised by Kenneth Gibson earlier on. But far too often in our society, it is women who bear the brunt of injustice, women who are forgotten and left behind. And I hope more broadly that the WASPI Women's campaign has changed how some of these issues are discussed and dealt with. I pay tribute to that tireless campaigner who knew that what had happened was not right, and called for justice. And this Public Health Service Ombudsman report, it only exists because of that campaign. So on these benches, we know just how much this campaign means to them, and we're pleased to see them finally receiving that recognition. But recognition clearly is not enough. And the UK government must urgently respond to the PHSO report, and we in the Labour Party urge them to get on with that important task as quickly as possible. Labour, of course, is not in power, and so it is for this government to act now on the recommendations in the PHSO report. WASPI women have been let down for too long, and they deserve better than government intransigence, dither and delay. They must be engaged with, and the UK government must work with them to develop that scheme. And I do reject, I have to say, Kevin Stewart MSP's view that the time for dialogue is at an end. This is the scheme that must be developed with the WASPI women, must be done with them rather than to them. And our Westminster Labour colleagues are also engaging with the report fully and developing our own response. On these benches, we are desperate for a UK Labour government, and we believe that it can make changes, significant changes in these areas. But as part of our considerations, any party with a realistic chance of forming a government owes it to the public to be as honest as we possibly can about the economic and fiscal realities bequeathed to them, in this case, by the economic carnage of the Conservatives' 14 years of austerity and a trust-induced economic meltdown. And Labour will not make uncosted spending commitments or promise unfunded tax cuts like the Tories. We must be honest with the public about the challenges in our public finances and the difficult decisions that would be required if we were to have the privilege of serving as forming a next UK government, in order to fix that mess that the Tories have left behind. For that reason, I cannot make uncosted commitments with specific compensation numbers. But Paul Wilkane, MSP, in opening this debate for Labour, set out very clearly our agreement with the principle of the recommendations in the PHSO report, and we want to see that acted upon. We are also determined that a Labour government will look after our pensioners. And I reject wholesale some of that rhetoric from SNP benches regarding future pension provision. That's why we are committed to the triple lock and why we put it in our amendment today. And I hope that the SNP government is able to back that. When we were last in government, we lifted 1 million pensioners out of poverty and introduced pension credit. When the Tories broke the triple lock, we campaigned against it and have pledged to retain it should we have the chance to serve in government. If the public gives us that chance to serve in government again, we will grow the economy, get our public services, our NHS, crucially, back on their feet, and restore the public finances to a sustainable footing. No, I'm just closing, I'm afraid. This is the kind of sensible, grown-up government that people across our country, including pensioners, are crying out for. So I close by paying tribute again to the WASPI women. I look forward to justice being delivered.
Thank you. I now call Megan Gallagher. Up to 7 minutes, Ms Gallagher.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Parliament was not scheduled to hold a debate on WASPI women today. The original debate, of course, this afternoon was on positive masculinity, and I was looking forward to talking about men's sheds and how they're helping men to open up about their mental health, but also creating generations of role models that will help and support younger men so they too can become role models in their family and amongst their friends, especially when it comes to relationships with women. Considering the Equalities Committee is looking at suicide prevention and suicide is the biggest killer in men under the age of 35, I do hope that this debate can be rescheduled, and I am pleased that Paul O'Kane has also called on this debate to take place at another point. Turning to the crux of the debate today, my party leader Douglas Ross has set out the Scottish Conservative position on the WASPI campaign, and I want to echo his remarks and others when congratulating the women who have been relentless in their efforts to obtain compensation for the changes to their state pension. This view, of course, has been echoed by many members during their contributions today. Presiding Officer, I've often stood up in this chamber and fought for women's issues since being elected in 2021. I recognise how painful this campaign has been, and I don't think any government would ever intentionally try to cause hurt and anger, but I do see the reasoning for creating more parity and equality for men and women when it comes to being in receipt of a state pension. But this is something that WASPI women, of course, also recognise. It has never been about the decisions, it's about how the decisions were carried out. And I think that's why it's right for the UK government to carefully consider the Ombudsman's findings before updating MPs in Westminster. Some MSPs this afternoon have reflected on the WASPI campaign and particular journeys of women. We have heard that women have been negatively impacted, whether that be financially or emotionally, by decisions that have been taken. And of course, the First Minister rightly mentioned that all political party leaders have pledged their support to the WASPI campaign. Presiding Officer, there's been a long list of women mentioned by colleagues who have never given up, who have kept going and have made sure that their voices have been heard. And I think it is right to pay tribute to Sheila, Linda, Lorraine and every woman who has written a letter, who has attended an elected member's surgery or given evidence about how they have been affected by the changes in state pension age. Some of our MP colleagues have also been mentioned, Caroline Harris, Tim Houghton, Peter Aldis, all of taking this issue to Westminster to fight on behalf of women. Presiding Officer, MSPs this afternoon have referenced the report from the Parliamentary and Health Services Ombudsman, and it's fair to say that the outcome of the report has caused a lot of the discussions today. It has taken 5 long years. This issue has been raised consistently by Ross McCall and others. But the report also concluded that there has been significant issues, even though that it has concluded that timely and accurate information was available about changes to the number of qualifying years needed for a full state pension. But I think it is the case that many women did not understand the situation in terms of their own personal circumstances, how the new state pension impacted them personally, and that the DWP did not adequately use feedback and research to improve its service and performance. That's the unintended consequences that have been referenced by Jeremy Balfour and others. The report also concluded the maladministration of DWP's complaint handling that's caused complaints and unnecessary distress and anxiety, also the lost opportunity for women to make informed decisions about personal autonomy and financial control. But most importantly, the report has recommended that those suffering injustice be compensated financially, and I don't think anybody who has made a contribution today in the Chamber has argued otherwise. That's why the Scottish Conservatives, in our motion today, calls on the UK Government to respond in full to the substantial report and its recommendations contained as quickly as possible, including that of compensation. Presiding Officer, Douglas Ross gave a passionate speech that aims to unite Parliament, and our amendment today is also one of consensus. MSPs were asked earlier to rise to the challenge. Yes, I will.
Christine Graham.
I think the issue with your amendment is you seem content with the the member seems content that the maximum level of compensation is £2,950. Surely a member cannot think that that is a reasonable offer.
Megan Gallagher.
I thank Christine Graham for her intervention. Douglas Ross explained in an intervention to Maggie Chapman earlier on that This is about getting consensus from the Parliament today, and we could certainly return to look at those issues. I think that is a reasonable ask. This is about trying to unite Parliament. That was the discussions that we had earlier on, and I'm hoping that that is one that we should all be able to rise to today, especially now that we've got different circumstances and we're now working within a minority government situation in Parliament. I think this is the first test, Presiding Officer, and it is one of the best opportunities actually to try and unite MSPs behind WASPI women. This shouldn't be about party lines. Politicians of every party has raised issues about the WASPI campaign, and I do think we can come back to issues about compensation at a later date. We can have another debate on WASPI women and the WASPI campaign. It is a really important issue, and I don't think there's any issue with coming back and having those discussions again. But if I could reflect on Beatrice Wishart's speech, which was one that I really enjoyed listening to, because it was about how we've saw the rise of feminism in this country and how some of the women impacted were actually the women who were behind that rise of feminism, making sure that they were fighting for equality, equal rights, and standing up for rights through really difficult times. They've tried to make their lives better for future generations, and of course they are the stalwarts who have passed the baton on to younger women for them to continue on that fight to achieve equality. So I will close today by echoing the calls made by Douglas Ross and ask the government if they could support our amendment tonight. We are trying to reach beyond the political divide to send a unified message to the UK government that the recommendations be implemented in full and that the women impacted receive the compensation that they deserve. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call on Shirley Ann Somerville to wind up the debate up to 9 minutes. Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And it's a privilege to close this very important debate on behalf of the Scottish Government. And it is also a privilege to do so alongside my friend and colleague, the First Minister. His support for the WASPI women is unquestionable and unwavering, as is his support for equality and his fight against injustice. And I look forward to campaigning side by side with him once again in the future, just as we did long before we got involved in elected politics together. Now on to this very important issue today, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government has been consistent in our calls for the UK Government to immediately right the wrong suffered by the WASPI women. With the publication of the PHSO report, the UK Government simply cannot waste any more time. Compensation must be delivered now and in full. Now, along with the First Minister, I had the privilege to meet some of the WASPI campaigners here in Parliament once again today, to hear once again directly from them about the need, which I fully agree on, for the urgent action for the UK Government. As the First Minister said to them and has repeated in the Chamber again this afternoon, this is about justice and it's about compensation. And I do think and hope this is something that we can unite on. Now, the PHSO report clearly identifies the need for compensation due to maladministration through the DWP Failures Act promptly in writing to the women impacted by the changes in the state pension age. They also, incidentally, called on governments to prioritise this action. Now, it's vital that the UK Government and the DWP takes responsibility for these failings, but also that it delivers that full compensation package at the earliest possible time. And I would call on the UK Government to listen to the WASPI women's calls for a comprehensive compensation, taking into account the financial hardship suffered, coupled with the UK Government having one of the worst gender pension gaps in the OECD. Presiding Officer, it is time to stop letting women down. Now, in the PHSO report, there is criticism, quite rightly, against the maladministration when communicating the equalisation of state pension age for men and women. As the First Minister has noted in his remarks, this Government fully supports Alan Brown MP's bill, carrying full cross-party support, which calls on the UK Government to publish a compensation framework for WASPI women set at £3,000 to £10,000 or more. Something the WASPI campaigners also feel would be a fairer outcome, given the wider financial hardship this devastating policy has had. Kenny Gibson, quite rightly, has highlighted Patricia Gibson's backbench business debate. Now, those are two opportunities, Presiding Officer, for Tories and Labour to support WASPI women, or not, and they will be judged on their action or inaction on this case. Now, the PHSO have made the highly unusual step of urging the UK Parliament to intervene to make sure the UK Government act on the recommendations in the report. And I hope the debate will add to those calls. Not only has the UK Government failed to take any clear commitment to addressing this report seriously or urgently, but it's also disappointing to note that there have been no calls from other UK Parliament parties calling on the UK Government to act on the findings of this report, with the exception of the SNP.
Douglas Ross.
I'm grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for giving way, and she is summing up this debate in the spirit it's been held, one of fairly consensual contributions. The amendment I've lodged today absolutely states that the UK Government should respond to the PHSO report in full, including the recommendation on compensation, and do so as a matter of urgency. It's almost identical language to the Scottish Government's motion. Could they, even at this late stage in the debate, consider supporting my amendment so the message then that goes to the UK Government is one of unanimity from the Scottish Parliament, and then we come back at a later date, at a time scheduled by the Government, supported by us, to have a full debate on the entire WASPI compensation?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I was going to come to the Tory amendment later, but let me do so now. The Government can't support it, and I'll be very clear about why. It takes out, you must now urgently deliver on the Ombudsman's recommendation to pay compensation in full to those women without delay. You then take out, or the Scottish Conservatives then take out, the WASPI women's calls for higher levels of compensation. So with the greatest respect, I listened very carefully to what Douglas Ross said today, but we can't just go on the words in the chamber. Let's look at the devil in the detail of what the Conservative amendment means, and I'm afraid that is letting WASPI women down again, and we simply will not do that today, Presiding Officer. Now, Presiding Officer, this is a minority parliament, and that does bring new and greater responsibility for those of us within government, but also across the chamber. Now, I'm very aware as a Scottish Government Minister of my responsibilities in a minority government, and I know that whoever takes office as First Minister in the coming weeks will do that too. I take that very, very seriously. But my ask today is to unite on the WASPI Women campaign calls. That's what we're trying to do in the Scottish Government today. Because minority government doesn't just shine a light on the Scottish Parliament, it shines a light on how we all act within it. It shines a light on what we will vote on today. So this is the first substantive vote since we've served as a minority. So we all have a choice, every single one of us. And the representatives of the WASPI women are in the gallery today. Now, I've dealt with the Tory amendment. Let me come to Labour. And I do ask them what they will do tonight, because many of the WASPI women will have met with them over the years. They will have marched with them. They will have applauded with them. But the difficulty with the Labour amendment is that there's caveats now on that compensation. Yeah. There was no caveats when they marched together. There was no caveats when they applauded them. And this is where there is a real, genuine possibility to not delay as the Conservatives have, to not put caveats on as the Labour Party have, but to come together to serve the WASPI women as I think they want us to do. And I'm happy to give way to Paul O'Kane.
Paul O'Kane.
I'm very grateful. I do find it quite bewildering that this government has decided not to back, I think, a reasonable amendment from the Labour Party, which has sought to create a consensus, has sought to create the voice of WASPI women in the preparation of that compensation scheme, but crucially also seeks to protect the triple lock. I find that very strange indeed.
Cabinet Secretary.
Now, I greatly respect Paul O'Kane, so I'm sure he didn't mean to somehow suggest that if we back the WASPI women, you can't back the triple lock. Yeah. You can do both things, Presiding Officer, on this. But I don't think that's what he meant, and I think that's important to say. The reason why there's a difficulty with the Labour amendment is that, as Maggie Chapman pointed out, given the figures that we have, seven women may have died as we've talked about this today. That's seven WASPI women. They don't have time for us to have another debate. Yeah. They don't have time for us to think yeah. about that level of compensation. Their asks have been clear. Their asks have been clear for years now. We have that opportunity, yes, to unite. We keep this motion simple about what the WASPI women have asked for, and that's what I would urge Parliament to do today. Don't listen to me. Don't even listen to the First Minister. Listen to the WASPI women in the gallery and those that they represent. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. Thank you. That concludes the debate on WASPI, Women Against State Pension Inequality. It's now time to move on to the next item of business, which is consideration of business motion 13042 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau setting out a business programme. And I call on George Adam to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And moved.
Thank you, Minister. No member has asked to speak on the motion. Therefore, the question is that motion 13042 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. The next item of business is consideration of business motions 13043 and 13044 on stage 2 timetables for bills. And I ask any member who wishes to speak on the motions to press their request to speak buttons. And I call on George Adam, on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, to move the motions.
Moved, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. No member has asked to speak on the motions. Therefore, the question is that motions 13043 and 13044 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motions are therefore agreed. And the next item of business is consideration of Parliamentary Bureau motion 13045 on parliamentary recess dates. And I ask George Adam, on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, to move the motion.
Gladly moved, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. The question on this motion will be put at decision time.